Perfect. Good. All right. Well, thank you for the invite. Thanks for inviting me to talk. And yeah, apologies, I can't be there in person. The commitments of my new role meant that I couldn't make it. But I'm really pleased to be able to talk to you today about something I care a lot about. And I think in bioinformatics is another environment where I think lots of the things I'm going to talk about today are particularly relevant. So yeah, I'm at Space Telescope Science Institute, which is a pretty big mouthful. Just to give you a little bit of background about them, they are the people who run the Hubble Space Telescope, for example. And we have an operational responsibility for telescopes flying around in space that NASA launched, basically. And so we do all the data management and processing of the data for NASA and on behalf of the community as well. So in case you like reading about open source, it's probably worth pointing out that this talk is a riff on an existing talk on an existing title of a post, which is actually by my ex-colleague now, Nadia Eckbart, which was how has she stumbled upon the internet's biggest blind spot. And this is a sequence of articles she wrote about the funding gap that there is for open source software, and how many areas of industry depend on open source software, but that it's kind of a lot of it's underfunded work. And so I enjoyed her writing, and so kind of picked a bit of a riff on that. She also had a really nice report that I would encourage you to read if you're interested about ways in which people are thinking about funding open source and kind of large open source projects. There's some work that she did with the Ford Foundation. So what I want to talk about today is broadly software, and this is I think academia's biggest blind spot, one of them. And software, I think, in this talk, we could replace a lot of what I say today with maybe data as well. Some people enjoy discussions about whether software is just a special kind of data. I think we can talk about that at a different time. But broadly, the arguments I'm going to make today apply equally to data products as well as software. And from a very high level perspective, software is important. There was a survey of a large group of academics from across disciplines about 10 years ago now, and 90% of people who are doing writing papers and being practicing academics said that software is either important or very important to their research. So it's a kind of critical part of the research cycle. It's also everywhere. Whether it's John Deere, is a pretty recognizable farm vehicles to the audience. This is a company that we think builds tractors, and yet they could consider one of their core competencies as an organization the software that they build and run on their hardware to allow their hardware to be more productive and their farmers more productive. So software is everywhere. It's ubiquitous in many industries, and is becoming increasingly important. Going back to this is a Gail Marco, who is a principal, one of the core contributors to scikit-learn, has a nice kind of overview of kind of software's relationship to academia here. Software turns a theoretical model into a constant of predictions. It controls an experiment and extracts from raw data evidence supporting or rejecting a theory. And I think this is a really good, for me, is a really good kind of highlight of the areas of the kind of research cycle that software touches. It is everywhere, and it becomes increasingly important as we think about bigger science experiments. And for astronomy and the kind of audiences that that I would spend most of my time talking to these days, this is the next big survey telescope in astronomy. This is the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope. It's a telescope that's being built right now in Chile, and it's going to survey the whole visible sky every three nights and effectively do video astronomy. That's about an 8-meter mirror that the telescope has going to produce. These data rates aren't particularly impressive to bioinformatics people, but I'll say them anyway. Something like 50 terabytes of data a night. So an awkward amount of data to handle, but it's going to produce unprecedented amounts of data for what we call time domain astronomy. And you know, the point about these big data projects and these centralized data projects for astronomy and for any domain science is that the tools that you use and the ways that you interact with these projects, the software is kind of a critical part of the product of these missions or of these instruments. I'm familiar with, this is embarrassing to show this slide to this audience, but anyway, here's a new generation sequencing device that people are very excited about. You know, the ubiquity of genomics data and the volume of genomics data that's being produced is obviously not decreasing. I think, interestingly for me, bioinformatics has the term bioinformatics, and I think it's interesting to think about similar domains or similarly sort of data-intensive, computation-intensive fields that really don't have the same sort of understanding of that specialism. I mean, there is a term astroinformatics, you know, the sort of informatics of doing astronomy, but it's really not a widely used term. And I think bioinformatics, I think one of the things that I think the sort of genomics and biology communities did well is that it's actually bioinformatics is a thing, a recognized kind of a domain that you can specialize in, and I think that's important. And astronomy certainly doesn't have the equivalent, even though we address many of the same problems. And so not all of these are, you know, experimental results. Astronomy does lots of simulations as well. This is a snapshot of one of the big Millennium simulations. What we're looking at here, the filamentary material here is. These are where there is mass in a simulation, and the bright blobs here are galaxies being formed in early models of the universe. And the point about data products like this, synthetic ones in this case, is that you know increasingly deep intellectual contributions, scientific contributions, are encoded in the software that is written. And this is a quote from Victoria Stodden, who's a mathematician and statistician at she's at University of Illinois these days. She thinks a lot about making research more reproducible and making being more explicit about how we capture all of the you know constituent parts of the research cycle with a focus on reproducibility and our ability to reproduce and each other's work. And so the problem with having software as a blind spot is that, you know, there's increasingly this sort of fear, I think is probably the best way to describe it, that increasingly we're compartmentalizing the software or the methods that we rely upon as academics to produce our work. We're kind of throwing data, maybe it's genomics data or maybe it's you know, simulation data in astronomy or observational data. The raw data goes through some set of transformations, some set of analyses, some reduction, and then we publish the results at the end. But the problem with that is that the thing that we're publishing most of the time is just a paper, and we're publishing you know some results, maybe some figures, but the things that are actually encoding a lot of the complexity and the analysis, the software, the methods, the algorithms, maybe there's the odd paper about these things, but they're generally less visible as a research product. And this is a problem, this is my attempt at a XKCD style plot of this problem. As we become more data intensive as a field, our chance to, or our ability to reproduce this work decreases if we only sort of place value on and only publish in the forms of papers, and we don't think about the rest of the research output. And you know, there's scary slides like this that come from studies of you know retractions in the literature, and you know the number of retractions that are happening. And you can see you know, PubMed and Web of Science here, and the reasons for why these retractions took place. But you know, basically, there's this sort of fear that we're becoming less reproducible as we become more data intensive, and this is an issue. So the thing I'm interested in talking more about today is really how do we kind of unpack the box where we're currently throwing in all the things that we don't typically publish on very much, and that maybe we don't even have career paths built around being good at, like being a good software engineer in academia. research and increase transparency. But I think right now, if you're writing software in academia, there's very few incentives for the individual who is maybe having a sort of hybrid career, publishing software and or authoring software and publishing papers. Very few incentives for the individual to actually push hard on publishing their software and paying as much attention to that as they would a paper. And I think the thing that's missed often in research settings is that software can be a competitive advantage for a research group, a research institute, whatever size you want to think about. And so, as Michelle mentioned in the introduction, I had some time at the Wellcome Trust Sanger Institute, and a really interesting time. It was about 2008. And this is my kind of one slide summary. Who knows if anyone has better numbers than this? But the Human Genome Project, we were kind of a single project institute. We had one thing that we did, and everybody had been working on that for 10 plus years. And the thing that changed was that we went from having one project to hundreds of projects. We were suddenly sequencing, well, as far as I can tell, anything that we could find. And we had a ton of Perl modules, just an absolute metric ton of software, just everywhere, everybody, a whole bunch of different code running in different places and different environments, but all tailored for this single project. And you will all know this slide, and actually I'm going to skip over these because these are actually I'm teaching your grandmother to suck eggs. I don't know if people use that phrase in Canada, but hopefully it translates. But the only thing that was different when this new sequencing technology came along, and these are the original Illumina sequences, that is the root username and password, by the way, on the computer, in case you were wondering, was that we suddenly had continual change. We had an institute that had all this software and all these processes built around a single project, the same instrument, the same genome, the same lab process all the time, the same sample prep. And we had no way of delivering, doing research with a multitude of projects with a new sequencing technology. So we embarked on building out new tools, and these are primarily kind of LIMS tools. There's a thing that was called SequenceScape. I think it's still running. But we radically changed the way that we build tools in a way that incorporate and adopt to a continually changing environment in terms of how we were actually working as an institute. And that was a key advantage for us in the early stages with this new technology that had been a real driver of change for the institute. The other place I've been lucky to see this, I think, is with the Galaxy Zoo project, which is a citizen science project that was launched in 2008. And it was it was kind of a runaway success. I don't know if this picture is going to work very well on your screen, how good your projector is, but there's a galaxy in the middle of that, screen. It's kind of a fuzzy blob. And at that point, the kind of competency of machines to do a good morphological classification of the galaxy was way below that of a human classifier. These problems aren't too dissimilar from, cell classification. There's a lot of, I think, overlap in the literature between people trying to look at microscope slides and classifying different cell types and looking at galaxies. And we had this opportunity to go from a single project to a whole collection of projects, which became the Zooniverse. And this is this platform for citizen science. And I think one of the really important things about this project is that we took the software with a kind of a core competency of what we did. The science that we produced was still primarily the way that we judged our output success, but the tools that we built, we had a flexible kind of domain model. This is a Galaxy Zoo decision tree that we're looking at here. But we had a domain model that could support a whole host of projects. And so there's a whole bunch of efficiencies in the way that we built out projects like Galaxy Zoo and Snapshot Serengeti, which is still live. It's a fun project looking at pictures of animals on the internet in the Serengeti, if you're interested. It's a lot of fun. Planet 4, looking at craters on Mars and classifying features on the surface of Mars. But the software was in terms of how we consider like what our core competencies were as a project. We judged our scientific output as the kind of currency of success, but we, you know, there was a strong recognition that software was our competitive advantage as a team. And so these are two examples of, I think, when software was seen as a strength, but in truth, both of them were, you know, special cases, and for different reasons. One, you know, Welcome Trust, there were thousands of people on site, well, probably about actually 1,000, but you know, hundreds of engineers, and again, in a bioinformatics institute where there was career progression, you know, from or at least some hope career progression on an engineering track in the organization, even if you weren't writing papers. And you know, the Zoomverse was staffed with people who essentially had given up on trying to be an academic. They were mostly focused on writing software, and that was their, you know, that was what motivated them, and that was the career path that they picked. But as I was saying before, I think, you know, as fields become more data intensive and software becomes increasingly important to a whole host of research domains, the thing that's interesting to me is, you know, what is required for these not to be special cases? What is required to make, you know, software what's required to make it possible for people who want software to be their academic contribution or their primary contribution in a research setting? Like, what do we need to do to enable that to be routine? And there's a nice blog post by a guy called Jake Vanderblast, who's an astronomer and data scientist at the University of Washington. And he summarizes this, you know, the risk, I guess, here particularly well, that the skills required to be a successful scientific researcher are increasingly indistinguishable from the skills required to be successful in industry. And, you know, and I think this is a really, especially in fields where data science is becoming increasingly important, you know, the things that you do as a person who, you know, analyzes large volumes of data, uses, you know, machine learning routinely in your work, and is diligent about, you know, statistics and process, you're a highly employable person outside of academia, and you can probably go and, you know, double or triple your salary in a heartbeat. So, you know, this is a risk to universities and to research communities at large. And one of the problems with that is that software currently isn't a creditable research output. If you invest a whole bunch of time and effort into software producing a high quality package that may be used by a large number of your peers, you may write a paper about that, but that's probably all you will ever do, and we don't really know how to appropriately credit that. And so we need to find a way to legitimize, you know, Phil Bourne at NIH summarized this well, we need to find a way to legitimize software as a form of scholarship. And so for the rest of the talk today, I wanted to talk about why software isn't a credible research output, and what maybe we could do to fix that, and talk this through. And so you know, there's a bunch of challenges associated with thinking about how and where software sits in sort of the output, the sort of credible output of researchers. You know, it's and some of these challenges are technical ones, like we just the infrastructure that we rely upon as academics doesn't support software. Some of them are just purely cultural. We just don't think of software in that way. And so, you know, citing software is I think a technical and cultural challenge. I probably should have put it down under both there. Like, how do you cite a piece of software? Like, if you do that, is it picked up by the people who index citations, like Web of Science and Scopus and Google Scholar? The answer is no to all of those three. Software citations aren't actually allowed by lots of journals. Journals won't let you include software in the references. They'll say, oh, that needs to be in an acknowledgement or something. So journals just simply don't consider software a thing that should be cited. There's the issue around, like, what does software need to be citable? Does it need to be on a public website? Does it need to have a DOI, a document object identifier? Does it need to be archived somewhere? Like, what do we need to do to make something a citable entity? I kind of covered this a little bit before. If you do cite software, then the tools that do the indexing that give us things like H indexes as individuals. They are their software citations aren't indexed even if they exist. We don't really know how to peer review software in certainly in a journal setting. I would argue we do this well in open source communities. I think peer review happens all the time in pull requests on GitHub and in code review environments. But you know, I don't think we have a good set of cultural norms in most academic fields about how to judge each other's software. And actually, you know, how does software cite other software? I mean, I'll talk about that in a little bit, but I think that's also an issue. And so I want to talk about solutions. Like I you know, hopefully it hasn't been too depressing and upset about everything so far, but I want to try and put a positive spin on this. I think there's a bunch that we can do as individuals, as groups of professionals, or out in the ecosystem to address some of these challenges. And so I'm going to spend some time talking through those. And as I say, they're broadly categorized into things that are self-service. What can I do today as an individual researcher to improve the status of software or the status of people writing software? And then what can we do as groups of academics? And then what are our kind of external dependencies, things that we can't necessarily fix ourselves, or that we have to go and kind of lobby or work hard to give feedback to people who have products that, and services that we rely upon? So the first one is to write software papers. Like, this is the thing. You can write a paper about your software. If you've written a piece of research software, you can write a paper about it. We know how to do that. You know, writing a paper is a good thing to do. We know how to cite them. We know how indexes know how to index them. We understand what a paper looks like, what review looks like, and effectively we have a paper that describes maybe with some novel results. It points at a piece of software and says the code is over here, and I have this kind of proxy object, which is a paper that's actually describing a piece of software. But okay, let's do that. So we can do it. That works, and lots of people do it. But there's it's work, and writing a paper is a significant amount of effort, and so that's if you've already spent a bunch of time writing software, maybe you've been really diligent and written a ton of good documentation, you're now going to write a paper as well just to make it credible and a research output. Well, that's not ideal. Also, you're probably the journal that you usually publish in with your research results won't accept a software paper. Like, they're just not allowed, so you have to go and publish in a left field journal that maybe doesn't count in tenure review committees in your research institute. And actually, like, authorship is kind of a problem, because if this is actually a long-term piece of software, then there's a very good chance that the people who worked on it 5 years ago are not working on it today. So do you publish a new paper every time you have a major release of the software? Well, maybe, but then you're getting into things like, you've got many papers that are all about the same piece of software, and then people start worrying about citation dilution, and that upsets people. And so there's kind of major issues with actually thinking about software papers as the fix, as the solution here. Although there's merit in doing it, for sure. Okay, so, well, what if we say, like, let's go beyond the software paper? What can we do that's different and maybe better than that? Well, what about making it possible to cite software? Just make it possible to, I want to just write my paper and cite software when I use it inline in the body of the text of my paper and include it in the references. Okay, and I think before we get too deep into this, it's worth thinking through, like, why do we cite? Because I think there's a bunch of different reasons that people answer this. These are probably the top four categories of, like, what is the purpose of citation? To show that we've done our research, to credit the work of others, to enrich scholarly records, make sure that, like, we've got a full description of the work done, to avoid plagiarism. I think primarily the reason I'm talking about today is, software citation as a mechanism of getting credit as the person who wrote that software, or giving credit to the people who wrote the software. So this is my primary focus today. So what would a software citation citation look like? Well, it might just look like this, right? Is this good enough? You know, the name of the author, the name of the package, maybe the version would be important in software, maybe a URL to some, you know, the package. Or, well, I mean, that might be a pretty complete one. Well, what's wrong with this as a software citation? You see this routinely in the literature already. People just say, we used package X, and they just put a web URL in. But there are many issues with the indexes, for example, for having just such a kind of loose string out there in the literature. Well, thinking about making it possible, how we can possibly cite software natively in the literature is definitely interesting and something that a whole bunch of people are working on right now. And so, okay, well, let's assume we can do it. From a technical standpoint, what are the kind of problems with that? Well, you know, a lot of, as I said earlier on, a lot of journals just simply do not permit a software citation. A lot of journals, even though like vast majority of journal content is read in digital form these days, you know, a lot of journals still have citation limits. Like, you can only cite 30 things or 40 things or 20 things. And so if you're thinking about, well, what's on my kind of top 10 or top 20 things that I should cite, then the random package that you use to convolve some, you know, signal from your instrument with some special statistical method that you use, it just might not make the shortlist, and so you have this kind of arbitrary cutoff. And even if we did have these citations, even if journals made it possible to cite software, the people who run the journals and the people who run the indexes aren't necessarily always the same people. So the people who give us our H indexes as individuals, you know, and count citations, they're not looking at software right now. And so this is, you know, even if we were doing it, would it be picked up? And so if it doesn't count, if the citations are not counted and doesn't fold into some metric that is used, then this is maybe not worth pursuing. I said that people working on this, there's a group in the Force 11 working group. Force 11 is an organization that thinks about future of research communication. They think about problems like this, software citation, data citation. There's a working group that I've been heavily involved with for the last year and a half, where we've specifically been talking about exactly this problem, software citation, how you do it, what are the principles of software citation. So if this kind of stuff is interesting to you, I encourage you to go and take a look. My problem with software citation and everything we've been talking about already is it's kind of like we're trying to, you know, shoehorn software into the literature in a way that just seems we're trying to make software, you know, look and feel like a paper, and maybe that just isn't the right approach. It's maybe just a kind of a fundamentally flawed approach. And so, you know, when I think about maybe alternative tactics, alternative approaches to think about career credit, or, you know, making software a research product that we understand and know how to credit people for, then I think it's worth looking outside of academia and looking at what communities are already doing. And I think, you know, another way to ask that question, and I'm influenced heavily by my time at GitHub here, is, you know, what does open source software do, especially well already, that's kind of different from the way that academia typically works? And I think one thing that open source recognizes well is that authorship isn't static. Authorship is a kind of transitive property of the software at any point in time. So if I go and look at something like scikit-learn, the package, and, you know, we're on GitHub here, of course, go and look, then there's something close to 600 contributors. It's probably more than that now. It's at least lighter, a couple of months old. And, you know, the tools that we use, this is just git short log, this is just pulling and counting the number of commits here, the tools that we use really have a, you know, really make it very easy to see, you know, who's been, you know, kind of ranking contributors by sort of their lifetime contribution. But then, of course, you can do things like, you know, segment and look on who's been working on the project the most in the last, you know, 18 months. And your authorship is something that is a very dynamic property and something that you can quickly kind of dive into and understand. well as metrics and verification of work. So Python package index ranking of the number of downloads that the project gets. It's really easy to see sort of how much people are using a piece of software, or with some caveats, or installing or downloading a piece of software. And a typical GitHub project will have all of these badges across the top of it that are all kind of signals of something, whether the tests are passing, how good the code coverage is, what kind of support it has for different variants of Python. This package has actually been deposited in Zenodo as well, so it has a DOI, so it's been archived in a way that can be captured in the literature. And we can dive into any of these environments, look at all of the tools, and clearly see, get a handle of the progress of the project and the kind of processes that they have for verifying their work. And I think that's very different from the way that we typically think about sharing our work and exposing progress in academia. The other thing I think open source does particularly well is dependencies. Like, a thing that many languages have pulled out, worked out how to do very well is, how does this software depend on other software, which kind of feels like a citation. It's an explicit dependency, and this is a website, libraries.io, that tries to pull all of these dependencies out and expose which projects rely upon others. And so this is the scikit-learn project. You can see here, it's just a giant list of those software that leverages, that includes scikit-learn. And so you've got this kind of dependency graph here that is effectively a citation showing that it's that this thing is using something else that's been maybe authored by something else. And again, this is how Ruby does it with their gem files. They have these explicit files that include the citation graph or the dependency graph in every project. So that makes me think about what if we try to use some of these ideas in an academic setting. And that sort of leads me to my kind of last kind of question, like, what is it that we're doing today? If we just kind of threw out the current system that we have, let's pick the best bits, the bits that we like, but let's, the assertion here is that we really have a credit system in academia that is primarily built around the paper as the only creditable output, and that's clearly deficient. So what if we were to go beyond that? What if we went beyond the H index? What if we went beyond the paper-centric H index and said, what could we do that would be better than this? And I think, firstly, the thing to say is this is really hard. I think it's a hard problem because it's not a thing that any individual is empowered to do, or even any kind of research group. This is a ecosystem problem. And we're talking big money here. We're talking about, like, Web of Science was recently sold to a private equity firm that they get tons of money from running this product, and sold for billions and billions of dollars, which is, this is big money, very entrenched parts of the academic ecosystem that we rely upon for our, in many ways, for our kind of signals of our that are relied upon for career progress. So, what if we could redesign the system to say, papers, data, software, anything should be citable, anything should be a credible research output. If it formed part of the research, if it was significant in the work, then it should, and it was produced by humans, or maybe even just instruments, whatever, however you think about the world, these are worthy of citation, and therefore, of credit being ascribed to the people who worked on that. And so there's an idea that was started by Dan Katz, who's at NCSA in Illinois, this idea called transitive credit. And he and I wrote an implementation paper idea that I wanted to talk through a little bit now. But very briefly, the idea of transitive credit is, let's say that instead of having, let's think about the way that we ascribe credit from a paper. So here's a paper I wrote, and because I wrote a paper, I probably cited myself. So I'm going to cite my last paper. I'm going to cite this other paper that was really significant for this work. And actually, there was a really important data set. This paper is about the WMAP data set in astronomy. So I'm going to cite the data product, but also as a comparison of two missions, I'm also going to cite the Planck mission data product as well. I used AstroPy, which is a very popular Python library in astronomy, and I also did some machine learning, so I'm going to cite scikit-learn as well. And the idea of transitive credit is that, firstly, you're citing everything that you've used, and then you award, you have a unit of credit to award across all of these things, all of these entities. And so I might give, you know, 30% of the credit to myself, 1% to this, sorry, 10% to Jones, and 10% to the data products, and close to 40% to the tools that I was using. The cool thing about transitive credit is it's transitive in its property. So, well, let's take AstroPy. What does AstroPy depend on? Well, it leans heavily upon a paper that was written by White, and it uses, leverages NumPy and SciPy underneath. And so, as you can see, hopefully, you know, if we keep going, what does White depend on? Well, we can then actually, you know, by proxy, I'm giving credit to NumPy indirectly. We have to build this credit map, this credit model. I'm basically, you know, the credit is a transitive property of every entity in the system. This is hard, and it's hard because it's not clear how to design the system well. And it's hard because we have no control. Even if we wanted to build such a thing, the ability to index all of the literature in a bunch of different fields is a legal and technical problem for lots of fields still. And so, you know, it's hard because we don't have control of the systems that we, as academics, rely upon. And so, this is actually the thing I just touched on there, transitive credit, is pretty much my research interest these days, thinking about scholarly communications and credit models. But I think we're honestly years away from even getting towards that kind of approach. And so the last thing I wanted to leave you on is, like, things that we can do today that are, you know, really concrete steps that we can take as individuals and groups that elevate the role of software in academia. And I think there are a few things. You know, as an individual, when you're reviewing a paper, in the reviewer feedback, you can say, hey, what software did you use? Like, where are the references to the software? Why aren't they here? Did you not use any software? Did you write any software? If so, where is it? You should include it. If you have the privilege of sitting on, you know, a 10-year review committee or an interview panel, like, including, thinking about non-paper contributions when assessing candidates and reviewing your peers, I think is a really important thing that we can do just to begin to advance the conversation. Understanding the value of software and paying attention to the ways in which we build software for some of these biggest most important science projects that we're working on today. You know, understanding that about that craft, software development as a thing to be good at, might require some professional development for you or your student. Obviously, I think sharing software on GitHub is a good idea, but publish your software, like sharing it with the world. There's a lot of people that kind of freak out about sharing their code, and the truth is probably nobody's looking. So, you know, if you're worried about the quality of your code, most people will just be pleased that you published it rather than you've got it hiding on a hard drive somewhere. So, you know, there's a bunch of different things we could do. None of them are complete solutions. But all of them, I think, would help us get a long way in improving, removing this blind spot that I think is software in academia. So yeah, thanks. I'll stop there.
Questions now, but he's going to be listening through the microphone, so if everyone can speak up when asking, and let us know if you can't hear.
Yeah, please shout if you ask a question, I can kind of hear people.
Anyone want to go first? No questions? Okay, I have a question. Go ahead.
So, are there fields like, you know, biology, bioinformatics versus astrophysics versus chemistry versus other fields where this is more of a problem or less of a problem for you, from what you know?
Yeah, so I think the question I think I heard was, are there fields where this is more of a problem or less of a problem? Fields where, there's probably a few different answers I give to this. There are some fields where I think there is a very solid recognition of the like role that software plays in research. And I think probably some areas of astrophysics are particularly strong on that, but some are pretty bad as well, actually. So I think there's a lot of diversity across that. I would argue that by virtue of the fact that bioinformatics exists as a discipline, like biology, like genomics, are doing better than some. But then my time at Sangam made me realize that actually, you know, the job description exists, but there's a very big divide between, you know, the people writing the code and the academics who are doing the science. And that exists for sure here at Space Telescope, where, you know, the prestigious roles are the academic track ones, not the engineering ones. I think there are fields where, I think anything where you're very tightly coupled to, subscription journals, where the system is very closed, I think there's big problems. So I think, you know, there's some fields that are more open than others. And astronomy is lucky that, you know, we actually run our own paper indexing service in astronomy. It's called the Astrophysics Data System. And so while people do use things like Google Scholar and other things like that, you know, the archive plus a very kind of liberal open access policy, like most journals in astrophysics don't mind if you put your papers up on the archive as well. That's just not a problem, that's just a convention. That plus some ownership over the infrastructure means that we're probably well positioned to make progress in these fields. But yeah, I think there is a difference. I think so probably, you know, the fields that are very tightly coupled to, you know, paywall journals where maybe less data intensive are probably the more traditional ones.
At the back?
Yeah, if some angel were to come and make a like web of science that's open and like that citation graph was free, anybody could have it, then could we have the transit of credit? And could we build these great credit models for software if that was in place?
Yeah. Could you hear that?
The next to the computer would be that, I don't hear it.
Yeah, so if the models, this is what I understood, if the models, if someone could create the models and we already had the network, is that what you're saying? Could it already be implemented?
Yeah.
The idea of like transitive credit?
Yeah,
I think it could. And I think actually one of the things I'm thinking about doing right now is taking a subset of the literature that's, for example, available on the archive and actually implementing the model and trying it out, because I mean, like, you know, I did what I presented was a very, very naive implementation of the idea, but I think it's worth, you know, I think it's worth trying it out. I think you can build the dependency graph for some areas. I mean, there's also the challenge of, you know, even if everyone was citing software in a formalized, standardized way today, well, they haven't been since, you know, day zero of the literature. So, you know, working out how to detect data and software references in the existing literature is actually a non-trivial problem. And so there are people who are thinking about just that problem in and of itself.
Okay, well, let's thank our speakers again.